thing I can't remember if I've shared before, I used to be on the swim team. Many years, actually. And a few years in, our coach was trying to teach us about how we could take our pulse. We could use that to help guide us and how much effort we were putting in, he said, because we could take our pulse at rest and then we could take our pulse after each workout. He'd tell us, feel the pulse, count the beats for 30 seconds, and then multiply by 2. That's your beats per minute. Problem for me wasn't the math. The problem was I could never find my pulse. And that greatly concerned me because your pulse is related to your heart rate. And for some reason, everyone else seemed able to find theirs and could record them on their workout sheet after our different workouts and they'd talk about them amongst each other. Where was my pulse? I knew that if I didn't have a pulse, well, that'd be difficult to explain. Later on, I learned there are other places you can take your pulse, like your neck, for example. And for some reason, worked better for me, anyway. Each heartbeat includes the contraction of different parts of the heart. And the pulse you feel here is related to the left ventricle pumping blood into the aorta and distal arteries. And that really made me reflect about the human heartbeat a lot. The human heart doesn't just all contract at the same time. It's a progressive contraction from the atria to the ventricles. It can't stay contracted continuously either. It also never takes a vacation. It's a fascinating process of events that not only have to go right, but also in order. It's going to require coordinating and electrical signaling. And so, like we often do, we're going to try to simplify this complex and amazing process, and we'll come back to the pulse thing a bit later too. Here is the human heart, and here are major structures of it that we've mentioned in our circulatory video, the major chambers, the ventricles, and the atria. I always remember A comes before V in the alphabet, so that helps me remember the atria are on top, and the ventricles are on the bottom. We had mentioned the valves, which prevent backflow of blood, and we also mentioned major arteries and major veins. We'll come back to this diagram. It's good to have the refresher. But you know, we didn't really go into detail about the muscle tissue of the heart. Myocardium, that's the muscle tissue in the heart, or you can call it cardiac muscle tissue. We've mentioned muscle tissue before, skeletal muscle tissue, smooth muscle tissue, but cardiac muscle tissue, the kind that is in the heart, has some special things about it. Most of the cardiac muscle cells, also called cardiac myocytes or cardiomyocytes, that make up the cardiac tissue are, first of all, very branchy, very interconnected. They usually have one nucleus per cell, some have two, and they're connected together by intercalated disc. These intercalated discs are super important because they have gap junctions. Remember, those can help cells communicate, and that's very necessary for them to coordinate. They also have desmosomes, the anchoring junctions, because you want to be secured when contraction is happening. Cardiac muscle cells have some serious work to do. On average, a human heart will beat around 100,000 times a day. So to break this down, we're going to consider a typical cardiac cycle. That's one heartbeat, which can include the mechanical contraction and relaxation and the electrical activity. But in this video, we want to focus on the electrical part. This means we'll be focusing on conductive cells, not contractile cells of the heart. So if we start in the relaxation state of the heart chambers, the impulse for the heart to contract starts in something called the SA node. It's a spot where specialized conductive cardiac muscle cells, known as pacemaker cells, are hanging out, concentrated in there. And these pacemaker cells in the SA node are different here than other cardiac muscle cells, different in structure and also different because they spontaneously depolarize. Just to note, the word spontaneous here in biology means that it occurs without some external stimulus, a little different from how the word spontaneous might be used when describing a friend. So we've got to mention something about membrane potential in the SA node. If you remember us talking about membrane potential in the past, we did this a lot in our action potential video. We talked about how if you were to have a recording microelectrode inside the cell, you could compare the charge in the cell with a charge outside of the cell if you had a reference electrode that is set to 0. Well, if you did that, you would find out a few things about the cells in the SA node. First, they don't really have a true resting membrane potential because that number is a little unsteady. But the most negative charge for the pacemaker cells in the SA node is around negative 60 millivolts. So consider the SA node. At around negative 60 millivolts, a current occurs in the pacemaker cells in this SA node. The current is actually called the funny current. Really interesting reason why. Check it out in our description. Can't say scientists don't have a sense of humor. It can also be called the pacemaker current, but you know which one I'm going to prefer. The funny current involves HCN channels being opened, which allow both sodium and potassium to travel through them, although much more sodium enters a cell than potassium leaves here. The positive sodium ions going into the pacemaker cells will greatly contribute to the membrane potential becoming more positive, and this marks the start of spontaneous depolarization. A reminder that by depolarize, if you remember from our action potential video, when the cells are getting depolarized, the difference in the electrical potential between the inside and outside of the cell is lessening. It's less polarized in the cell compared to its surrounding, which means, in this case, that the cells are becoming more positive. If the pacemaker cells in the SA node get to a threshold, which is around negative 40 millivolts, the action potential can happen, and then you will see that depolarization really ramp up. Calcium channels open to allow calcium to rush into the pacemaker cells. Membrane potential will now go from negative 40 millivolts to around plus 15 millivolts. The calcium channels will close and voltage-gated potassium channels will open, with potassium leaving the cells. When reaching negative 60 millivolts, voltage-gated potassium channels will close, and this can all repeat. You know, not getting as negative as many other cells is advantageous to pacemaker cells, as it contributes to why they can even spontaneously depolarize. And these pacemaker cells also tend to be surrounded by fibrous cells in the tissue they form. That tissue isn't good at conducting electricity, which is a good thing for ensuring the signal isn't thrown off by other signaling. So, we mentioned the electrical signal in the SA node. All of those events in the SA node were part of an action potential, as an action potential is an electrical signal a cell can generate. This action potential will spread to neighboring muscle cells in the atria, which will cause them to depolarize and contract. Now, you might assume that this signal will depolarize everything, or at least make its way down to the ventricles, but you'd assume wrong. A fibrous ring keeps a signal from conducting directly to the ventricles. But the action potential does propagate to something called the AV node. So here is the AV node, which is also in the right atrium of the heart. Location-wise, it's lower, or more specifically, inferior to the SA node. The AV node also has cells involved in conductivity, including pacemaker cells. Many of the conductivity cells in the AV node are a bit different from conductivity cells in the SA node, though. In a healthy human heart, the AV node propagates the action potential it receives from the SA node, and to emphasize, the SA node is the leader here. However, cells in the AV node can do spontaneous depolarization, and the steps to that would be similar to what we described for spontaneous depolarization of the cells of the SA node. And we mention that because that means that the cells of the AV node can be a backup if the SA node was to fail, but it would be a slower rate than the SA node pacemaker cells, and it's not ideal. In a healthy human heart, the cells in the AV node depolarize in response to the SA node's action. Importantly, though, the electrical signal will travel a little slower through the AV node than the SA node. This slower conduction causes a bit of a delay, a fraction of a second, but that's still very significant because that delay allows the atria time to contract and send blood to the ventricles. Structurally, a major contributor to the delay includes that these conductivity cells here in the AV node have a smaller diameter and less gap junctions, which can slow conduction. From the AV node, the action potential continues to be propagated to the bundle of His, also called the atrioventricular bundle. And this bundle has a right and left bundle branch, which supply each ventricle, respectively. From the bundle branches, you go to the Purkinje fibers. These are conductive fibers, and they spread the impulse to the cardiac muscle cells that are in the ventricles, ventricular contractile cells. It starts at the apex, which is actually here, and then to the base of the heart. This allows the ventricles to contract. Okay, so let's recap. What did we just go through? We focused on the cells in the heart involved in conductivity. That means with the electrical signal, specifically cells at the SA and AV node. These cells are a type of specialized cardiac muscle cells. The cells at these nodes can do spontaneous depolarization. We went through steps involving that. In a healthy human heart, the SA node leads with spontaneous depolarization and stimulates the cardiac muscle cells in the atria to contract. The cells in the AV node depolarize in response to the SA node's action. The AV node propagates the action potential, and then because the conduction is a bit slower, there's a bit of a delay, it will go to the atrioventricular bundle, bundle of His, to the right and left bundle branches, which goes to the Purkinje fibers, which stimulates the cardiac muscles and the ventricles to contract. All of this, the SA node, the AV node, the atrioventricular bundle, the right and left bundle branches, the Purkinje fibers, all of these are essential to the cardiac conduction system. When a human is resting, you can expect the SA node to be generating 60 to 100 action potentials a minute. Now keep in mind, these conductive cells, which are heart muscle cells, but again, very specialized ones, make up only around 1% of the heart muscle cells. So that means a great percentage of the heart muscle cells in the heart are actually contractile cells doing the actual contracting work. And we need a separate video to go into some more detail about that process. Needless to say, when I think about taking my pulse, I'm pretty amazed by all the coordination that is going into that. One last thing. In the medical field, a common way to evaluate the function of this electrical system of the heart is to use the electrocardiogram, which can be abbreviated ECG or EKG. Now, in very general terms, the ECG measures the voltage of the electrical signals in the heart from one point to another over a period of time. And the lines that can be printed on paper from the ECG have meaning to health professionals because they are trained to know the points of measurements and what would be expected in a heart with normal function. An ECG can help reveal problems with the electrical system of the heart. For example, atrial fibrillation, also called AFib. AFib can involve multiple sites of the atria being depolarized when they're not supposed to, and the electrical signal can be out of sync. The signaling issue ultimately means the atria can't contract well to pump blood into the ventricles, and this can increase the risk of a blood clot forming in the heart. The clot could have the potential to travel somewhere, like the brain, which could cause a stroke. Thankfully, though, tools like the ECG can help determine when there are problems with the electrical signal of the heart so that there can be a plan for treatment. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.